too hard for God, right?
Praise the Lord. Well, God is good, isn't he? Amen. Well, I'm sure glad that you're here, and I'm glad to be here with you. Amen. I just want to share a few things with you from the Word tonight before we minister to folks. Go with me to Proverbs chapter 4. Proverbs 4. I'm glad that Pastor mentioned about holding fast to your healing. That's so true. It's so important. A lot of times, you know, where everybody's believing God, you do get a lot of instant healings and notable things that happen, but when people don't develop a faith of their own, then a lot of times it slips. People will think, well, oh, you know, I thought the Lord healed me. I guess he didn't. Because you'll never be able to maintain for very long what comes by somebody else's faith without developing a faith of your own. Amen. You know, how many's ever heard of Benny Hinn before? All right. Now, I don't know so much what he's doing today, but back in the 90s, he had the largest crowds of any minister. And there would be 25,000, 30,000 people that would go to his meetings. There was a pastor friend of mine, very skeptical of Benny Hinn, especially when folks would fall under the power, and he'd wave his hand or wave his jacket or whatever. So he went to one of these meetings more out of skepticism than faith. And so he's there, and he's got it in his mind, I'm not going down. Well, sure enough, you know, next thing he knows, he's on the floor. Well, it was in a sloped floor auditorium, and the person behind him uphill had one of those great big 44-ounce big gulps that you can get down in the States, soda. And it got knocked over when everybody fell under the power. And so Pastor, he got soaked from his waist down, totally soaked. Well, he became a believer in Benny Hinn and humbled all at the same time. But how many in that crowd do you suppose came for healing? Lots. Thousands. How many of those that were ministered to, say in 6 months, were still healed? You're not too far off. About 400 out of all of those that came actually were still healed. And that really bothered him. And if I remember correctly, he had inquired of Doc Horton about what was the answer. You got to teach people faith. You got to give people the Word of God. See, a gift can be an operation, all right? And I minister with a tangible anointing of healing power, all right? But that will not do it for you, okay? I wish I could do it for you, because I would, but it doesn't work that way. Amen? You know, I can lay hands on you, but if you don't do your part, then nothing is going to happen. Okay? Like, for instance, there's people that they've been ministered to by the best, the cream of the crop. You know, I've talked with people that, you know, they had Brother Hagin lay hands on them, you know, Brother Copeland lay hands on them, Charles Capp, and they were still no better. Well, why is that? Because God expects something out of you. When God has moved and manifested himself in your life, then he requires you to at least cooperate with him a little bit. Right? Amen. And so I want to give you just a little bit of word that is going to help you. All right? My sole desire is to help you receive. if I could somehow, you know, crack your skull open and open up your head and just pour it in, I would do that, but I can't. Amen. But in Proverbs chapter 4, let's begin with verse 20. Now, you're familiar with all these scriptures. So we're not talking about anything new, something you've never heard of before. It's very basic. If you're looking for some newfangled angle, and I just made that up, looking for some newfangled angle on, say that 10 times fast, on the subject of healing, you'll be disappointed. It's not some newfangled truth that is going to get the job done. It's believing the old-fashioned truth that will get the job done. Amen? So notice here in chapter 4 of Proverbs, verse 20, my son, attend to my words. Notice in this little section where we're going to talk about healing, the first thing out of his mouth in this context is attend to my words. It boggles the mind how that you can be giving somebody the word of God and it just goes right over their head. Zoom. And they miss it. Amen. There was a gentleman that was coming to church while I was pastoring, and he never would bring his Bible. And a lot of the things that we were teaching and preaching, he was like, you know, yeah, I've heard that. Yeah, I know that. But he wasn't really hearing what was being said. He was always struggling, always, you know, trying to catch up, never really where he should be until he started getting into his Bible, bringing his Bible to church. Amen? Because, see, if a person's not willing to hear and ready to hear and actually hearing, you're really not going to receive very much from God. Amen? Praise the Lord. Now, and I'm only saying that to try to help folk. My son, attend to my words. Incline thine ear unto my sayings. Sure reminds me of when the folks came to Jesus, which came to hear him and to be healed. Let them not depart from thine eyes, and keep them in the midst of thine heart. Now, what do we keep in front of us? What do we keep in our heart? The word. The word that our ears have been attuned to. The word that has been spoken to us. We keep it in front of us constantly. Now, I'm not trying to step on anybody's toes, but if you're a person seeking healing, and once you have been ministered to, if it is your plan to continue to mope and to be woe is me and try to garner the sympathy of everybody around you, forget it. You're wasting your time. Amen? Now, years ago, I don't know how it is now, but there was a commercial for Lotto 649. Does anybody remember Lotto? Do they still have it here in Canada? Lotto 649? And they showed in the commercial everybody doing their happy dance out there in the streets, and just, you know, everybody's just jumping up and down and dance because they won the lottery and they're all excited, you know. Amen. Well, they were excited because they won the lottery, right? Faith is an act. If you really believe that you have received, you're going to notify your face. You're going to notify your feet. Amen? You can't go around with your bottom lip dragging the ground and moaning and groaning, crying and bawling and squalling, and expect to be healed. I'm sorry. Now, there's a lot of people. And my wife and I, we've had long discussions about this. Because, you know, when she's come with me, she's even seen it. Where if people couldn't talk about their latest ache and pain, they would have nothing to talk about. Their whole social life would come to an end. Now, I'm not being mean. I'm not being unkind. But it's the truth. I'm just trying to help folks. Amen. I like to see people healed. I like to see miracles happen. I don't like people to get a touch of the power of God and then 2-3 days lose it. Amen. I mean, there's places I wish I could go tonight and just sit down and teach them line upon line, precept upon precept, a drop here and a drop there, and just get faith into them, because then they'd be victorious in every area of their life. Amen. Instead of waiting for some pick-me-up. Amen. See, I don't want to play church, but church, too oftentimes, has just been nothing but, you know, precious moments. Cute little sayings and, you know, cute little chubby, you know, winged, shooting the little arrows or whatever. Amen. I mean, if you ever really came into contact with a real bona fide angel of God, it'd curl your hair. Amen. I was preaching in Wilburton, Oklahoma, by Robber's Cave. I know none of you have ever heard of it. You've been there, of course you have. And I was preaching away like this and walking across the platform, and I tripped. And I fell right into an angel. And I mean, I actually tripped and hit him and fell and leaned against him. And I looked up to where about where the ceiling is here, and that was his elbow. It took me about 2 days for my brain to just not be in tilt mode. To not be like, you know, the reset button. The reset button's not working. Amen. And I don't want to play with the things of God. They're real and they're powerful. Amen. And so if the word will help somebody, who are we to withhold that and not tell people the truth? I don't want somebody to just come up to me and, "Oh, Brother Greg, you know, just be warmed and be filled. You're so wonderful." And I mean, if there's some glazing problem that's keeping me from receiving, I don't want all the back rubs and shoulder rubs and, oh, you know, pat you on the back. I want somebody to get my attention and shake me if necessary. Amen. So that I don't keep going the wrong way and not receiving. Amen. Praise the Lord. And we all need people like that. Oh, yes, that's my ministry. I'm here to wake people up and slap them around. No, that's not necessarily your ministry. The Bible says, you know, how can you take the speck out of, you know, your brother's eye and you've got a beam in your own? Praise the Lord. Now, let's keep reading here. Let them not depart from thine eyes. Keep them in the midst of your heart. If you're just going to apply what we're learning, you know, for 10 minutes on Wednesday night and go home and just forget about it and you know, oh, yeah, you know, my, no. If you're serious about this, you got to keep it in front of you constantly. Amen. The Bible says that Abraham considered not his own body now dead, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. Amen. So if we're going to consider and keep our eyes focused on the sickness, the disease, et cetera, then we're going to be in trouble. The scripture here says, let not the word that we've heard depart from our eyes, keep it in the midst of our heart. Verse 22, for they are life unto them or those that find them, and health to all their flesh. God's word is life and health. God's word, or as the Hebrew says, health is medicine. God's word is life and medicine to all your flesh. Now, how many of you, you've ever gotten a prescription from the doctor and he'll say, take one pill and your disease or your condition will be totally cured? Not usually. Not generally. Usually he'll say, take this, you know, morning, noon, and night for 3 weeks and come back and see me. Because it takes time for that medicine to get into your system and begin to work and to reverse the process of sickness and disease, right? God's word is medicine, and it works by keeping it continually in front of your eyes. Now go with me to Isaiah, if you would. Isaiah 53. Isaiah 53. When you find it, say amen. See, some people question whether or not it's God's will for them to be healed. I was ministering in a certain place, and a gentleman comes up to me, and he was bent over. And he was crippled up. And he was so thrilled and so excited when he came up to me. He said, remember when you ministered to me last year? Well, you know, I thought for a moment, yeah, I did remember. He said, I have not had to have pain meds ever since you laid hands on me. And, I mean, he just, his eyes were glazed over with tears. He was so thrilled, and he was so happy that he did not have to have the pain meds that he had before. But yet he's still all bent over and crippled up. You can see there's still physical problems. I said something to the effect of, well, let's believe God for the rest of your healing. And I mean, a look flashed across his face that he never even considered it. He looked at me like a cow at a new gate out in the pasture where they all gathered around. They cocked their head back this way. And what in the world is that? And they're all looking at that new gate. Amen. And I could tell just by talking to him, he was not in a position to even hear it at that moment. He was so thrilled. See, he had one little slice of the pie and didn't even realize that it was all available to him. And the Lord dropped something in my heart to share with him. Now, see, I was going to be there for several services, and he couldn't be there for the next couple of services. But at the end, he was going to be there. And so I told him, I said, I want you to think about this. Roll this statement over and over and over and over in your mind. Just chew on it for the next couple of days that you're out. Is anything too hard for the Lord? I want you to think about that. See, he had settled into his fact that this is just the way that it is. He had come to terms with accepting that this handicap that was his burden to bear, his cross to bear, it was something that he was just going to live with. But he was so thrilled that he didn't have to have the pain meds anymore. And after a couple of days of chewing on that, he come back to the service, and we were ministering healing that night. The healing anointing went into him. Amen. Amen. Now, see, I know what that means. Now, I don't have to wait around and watch for a manifestation. That's not what's important to me. You see, when that anointing, now, I can lay hands on somebody, and the anointing will go in and come right back out. And I've laid hands on lots of people, and I know they did not receive. They might have had some little workup of emotion, But I know that that anointing didn't go into them. I've even told you about times where I just knew it didn't go into them. Amen. And come right back out. Sometimes pastors even, ministers that have laid hands on, just wouldn't go in, couldn't get it to go into them. But when it does go in, you know that they took it by faith. Amen. And you know that power is working on the inside of them to drive out sickness and disease and or condition or whatever it is. So notice here, did you find Isaiah 53 yet? For sake of time, we'll just look at verse 4 and 5. Now this is the great redemptive chapter that Isaiah prophesied concerning the Lord Jesus Christ. Actually, look at verse 3. He's despised and rejected of men. A man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. Now, the actual Hebrew words here is sicknesses and pains. Where it says sorrows and griefs. Now, in the New King James Study Bible, they'll have a footnote there that that's actually what the Hebrew says. Amen. A lot of your modern translations will actually say it that way, sicknesses and pains. We hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely, the strongest, most assertive word in the English language, surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Again, that's sicknesses and pains. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. He was wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Amen. Your healing was obtained for you at the cross. Well, I'm just waiting for the Lord to heal me. It was already bought and paid for. You got to just take it. Amen. Now, the Bible says that Jesus was made to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. 2 Corinthians 5:21. Put it up on the screen. Better make sure. Amen. If you can get that. 2 Corinthians 5:21, I believe it is. They're working fast. That's verse 1. 21. Yes. For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin. Jesus didn't have to sin to take your sin. He couldn't have done that. The Bible says he was made to be sin. In other words, your sin and my sin and the sin of the whole world was laid upon Jesus. Not upon his body, upon his spirit. Amen? And now that's up on the screen, but here in chapter 53 of Isaiah, he was wounded for your transgressions, bruised for your iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. In other words, the punishment needful to obtain peace with God was laid on Jesus. Nobody will dispute that. If you're a Christian, you have to believe that. Amen. If you can't believe that, then you're not saved. Amen. He became sin for you. He took upon his spirit your sin and he paid the penalty needful for you to have peace with God. When did he do that? On the cross. And do you believe that? Yes, you believe it. And with your mouth, have you confessed Jesus as your Lord and Savior? So what does that make you right now, right now, right now? Saved. Now, you're jumping ahead of me, whoever said that. All right? Now, notice here, and with his stripes. And with his stripes, you're what? Healed. And's a conjunction, isn't it? It joins what he just said to what he got through saying. Go back to verse 4. Surely he hath borne our sicknesses and pains. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. He bore. That word bore, it means to convey or to carry them away. When Jesus became sin, he conveyed that sin away, paying the penalty of it. Amen. With his own sacrifice, your sickness and your disease and your pains were laid also upon the Spirit of Jesus. Amen. Now we look on the outward side where the Roman soldiers whipped him and scourged him and pulled his beard out, put the crown of thorns upon his head, right? We see that. That alone was not what did the thing for us, did the job for us spiritually and with our healing. The Bible says it was God that did that. Not just the physical aspect of it, but the Roman soldiers could not make him sin for us, could not make him healing for us. God had to do that. So your sin was put on Jesus' spirit. Your sickness and disease was laid on his spirit. And when he died, he paid the penalty that was needful for you to have peace with God. It is as much God's will for you to be healed now as it is for you to be saved right now. Amen? And you've got to get that settled. Listen carefully. Surely he, Jesus, hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. It was God that did that. But he was wounded for our transgressions. Why would God do that? Because he loved you. And that was the price that was needful to have peace with God. Spiritually, physically, materially, in every way. Think about that. He was wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes, we are healed. 2,000 years ago, you were healed. Every bit whole and healed 2,000 years ago. Well, it sure doesn't seem like it. It just seems like my body's just a mess. I'm always sick. I'm a Christian. But how come if I was healed 2,000 years ago that I don't have it? Well, why isn't everybody saved? One, either they haven't heard, or two, they heard it and refused it. There is no need for a person, that is a big statement, no need for a person to remain sick. Just like there's no need for a person to remain lost. Jesus took care of both on the cross. Amen? He took care of it. So how did you get saved? You accepted him as your Savior. You confessed him as Lord. For with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation, right? You believed it in your heart, you confessed him with your mouth, and you were born again. Now, you don't doubt that. You don't question that because You did what the Bible said to do where your salvation is concerned. Do the same thing with where your healing is concerned. No different. You believe God's word in your heart and you confess Him as your healer with your mouth. And by faith, you just go, you stand up. Jesus is my healer. Thank you, Jesus. I'm receiving by faith everything that you provided for me in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, what if the devil comes along and says, well, you're not saved? You brush that off. Because you know in your heart, the Holy Spirit is bearing witness with your spirit that you're a child of God. Amen. Well, what if he comes up and says, well, you're not healed. Look at you got pain and you got all these aches and moans and groans. And well, what do you do? You don't pay attention to that. Just like if he said, well, you're not saved, you brush it off. No. The Bible says right here, by whose stripes ye, you are healed. And if I are healed 2,000 years ago, then I am healed now. Look at another verse of scripture here. Now, if Isaiah is not clear enough for you, Matthew chapter 8 interprets it into our language. Matthew 8. So there's no misunderstanding of what exactly Isaiah is talking about. Matthew chapter 8. Matthew 8. And I'll tell you what, I've had people in years gone by, it's been a while, they've said to me, Brother Greg, you're just hard. You're just so hard. I'm not hard. What I'm sharing is truth. And the scripture says you'll know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Amen. Now see, a lot of times people, they want to be coddled and cooed and all that. Now, I made a statement some time ago, and man, you talk about getting flack for it. See, what a lot of people are looking for is not compassion. What they want is sympathy. And the Bible does not teach the concept of sympathy. But it does teach compassion. See, sympathy says, I know how you're feeling, and goes on and doesn't do anything to help you. The Bible says Jesus was moved with compassion. Compassion will move to bring an answer and hope and help and healing.
Amen.
Amen. Sympathy will say on Facebook, well, I'm thinking about you. But compassion will actually get down and get on the ground with you and get dirty and get down there and help you out. Amen. That's compassion. You know, here's the pastor this was while I was going to that church many years ago. Pastor of one of the largest churches there in Oklahoma. Thousands of people. And here he is driving to church and sees a woman on her way to church from the church. Had a flat tire. He pulls over. And, I mean, he's going to preach in just a short time. And he's out there changing this single mom, as it turns out, changing her tire. And everybody else is driving to go to church. Thousands of people heading to the church. And here's the pastor changing the tire for this lady. Now, sympathy would drive right by that single mom, as it turns out. He probably didn't know it then, but drive right past, and then get up to the pulpit and say, you know what, folks? There was this lady that we passed by, and here she was having trouble, and nobody stopped. You know, let's all feel for her. No, he pulls over and helps her out. That's all that I'm doing right now, is pulling over and taking a few minutes to try to help people get back on the road. Amen. Now, notice here in Matthew chapter 8, verse 16, when the evening was come, they brought unto him many that were possessed with devils, and he cast the spirits out with his word and healed some that were sick. What does it say? How many? How many's all? Do I need to tell you the story? No, we won't take time. But the word all actually means all. I mean, absolutely unequivocally all. They brought unto him everybody in the whole region that was sick. Every last one of them. That, verse 17, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our griefs and sorrows. Is that what it says? What does it say? Tell me what it says. Our infirmities and bear our sicknesses. I mean, you talk about a divine commentary. You don't need to get Matthew Henry and Kenneth Wiest and you know, Google it up there on the internet. You've got Matthew right here who walked and talked and lived with Jesus and saw firsthand the fulfillment of Isaiah's prophecy in Jesus, saying himself took your infirmities and your sicknesses. What he took, you need not bear. Amen? Let's look at another scripture here real quick. Is that Bible or is that church doctrine? That's Bible. Now, it's what we believe here, of course, as church doctrine. But there's a lot of times church doctrine will deviate, now not this church doctrine, but will deviate from Scripture. I was listening to somebody, and while I'm talking, go to 1 Peter 2. Listen to the radio, Christian radio. Now, sometimes Christian radio, and I'm not talking about, you know, I'll just be real careful. There's some Christian radio that you might as well turn on the country western station, because it is sometimes just chock full of doubt and unbelief and poison. Amen. I'm talking about some so-called Christian radio stations. I'm not again. I love Christian radio stations. All right. And when I travel across, I'm constantly checking to find that next Christian radio station. Amen. But there's sometimes you come across some that, like for instance, here's a guy that this is what he said on the Christian radio station. We know God is a healing God over in Africa, but not over here in North America, because here we have doctors. But over there, they don't have, so God will heal over there, but he don't do that here. So what do? You click, because that's poison. That's death. It's poison. And people will get sometimes those same concepts and ideas because they've been religiously brainwashed rather than New Testament taught. We're looking here at Scripture. Himself took, if he took it. Now I'm going to do something pretty radical. Sister, now, is that your purse? That brown one, all right? Now, no. It's safe. Now, man, what do you got in this purse? That's not Kleenex. That's like kitchen sink. Now, what did I just do? Now I'm on video camera. All right? I took her purse. Whose purse is it? It's hers, but I took it. Who's got the purse? Who don't have the purse? If something's been taken from you, then why do you still whine and bellyache and complain for something that's been taken from you? There you go. There you go. If he took it, then why do I still claim it? Why do I mope around and act like I still got it? Yeah, but I can feel that I've got all the same symptoms. I've got all the same condition. It's nothing seems to have changed. Now, do you believe what your body tells you more than what God's Word tells you. Yeah, but Brother Greg, you don't have to deal with all the stuff that I have to deal with. Now, I'm not minimizing things that you and I have to deal with. Amen? But are you going to deal with it based on your carnal flesh, or are you going to deal with it based on what the Word of God says? The Bible says you'll know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Your fact won't make you free. My fact won't make me free. Only the truth can make you free. Amen? So at some point, you have to realize that there might be certain facts that are present in my body. But the fact does not change the truth. The truth says, by whose stripes ye were healed. 1 Peter 2:24. Whose own self bare our sin in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sin should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. See, Isaiah looked ahead to what Jesus would do and said, you are healed. Peter looked back to what Jesus had already accomplished and said, you were healed. Amen? So, Isaiah, we are healed. Peter, you were healed. So, we're on the were healed side. So, if I were healed, then I don't discuss and I don't talk and I don't accept anything that contradicts were healed. Amen? Now, yes, conditions might try to persist. Yes, issues might present themselves to us, but what do you believe? Well, I believe the Word. I believe what God says. And what happens is we turn loose then of all the things that have held us back. Just like for instance, I'm going to accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior, but I'm not going to give up sinning. Well, you're not going to be a very successful Christian, are you? You got to be at least willing to. Doesn't mean we're perfect. But if a person says, well, I'm just hell-bent on sinning the rest of my life, well, I'm sorry. You're in trouble. Amen? But see, a lot of times people do that where healing is concerned. Here's the Word of God. It's plain as day in the Scripture, but yet we continue because it is such a part of our lives that we really don't want to give it up. Amen? I'm encouraging you and I, let's give it up. Amen? Doesn't mean that everything instantly begins to manifest. But as we continue to grow in God's Word, then we keep rising up higher and higher and higher, and we're living more victoriously, more victoriously, more victoriously. Amen? And then, you know, you begin to walk in the fullness of your rights and privileges in Christ. Amen? You know, for instance, sometimes on a business, you'll see so-and-so and sons, Wooldridge and daughters, one company down the States. Well, what if those daughters are only 3 years old? Well, they don't have much influence on the business, do they? But when they're 30 years old and they've gone to college and they've gotten their degree and they've spent some time working their way up in the business, that's a whole different story, isn't it? Well, everything that Jesus bled and died for belongs to you the instant that you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, but not everybody walks in it. But when the light of the truth comes, see, your spirit right now is saying, yes, yes, that's the answer. That's what I've been looking for. Sometimes our head might be giving us fits. Our head might be saying, well, that's not what I've heard all my life. But if you listen to your heart, your heart's doing flips. Your spirit's doing flips because it's the truth of God's Word, and the truth makes you free. Now, I'm closing with this. My wife, she trains horses. And now I grew up with horses. We had horses, you know, as I was a teenager growing up and different things. But we didn't know nothing. I wish I would have known half of what I know now. We would have really enjoyed our horses back then. But, you know, we just took whatever anybody said as being gospel truth. And, you know, one person said, you know, before you ever ride, you got to take a tube before and whack them right between the ears. You know? And that's the way you get them calmed down. Well, you know, and sometimes instead of having a happy ride, it was more of a rodeo. You know, there was my sister had a horse. Her name was Daisy, and she was no Daisy. You talk about a snaggle-tooth nag, but she's a beautiful horse. And so she possessed. I don't doubt it. The neighbor's fault. But anyways, now let's get back to the spirit. She'll take a horse, and she'll begin to start the training process. And because she's experienced and she knows what to look for, she'll say, this horse has some trash in it. Some disrespect issues. Now, the average person wouldn't recognize what those disrespect issues are. Like if a horse comes and just nudges you like that. Now, if it was one of our horses, something's going to be swinging real fast to hit that horse. Because that is total disrespect. Amen. Total. If they're what they're doing is they're or if the horse will come and take his foot and put it right next to yours, man, I'm fixing to kick that horse as hard as I can, because what he's doing, he's testing me to see how much I know and to see what I will allow him to get away with. But what, now here's what will happen when I get home, all right? Whatever day that is, all right. I will go out to the pasture, and I'll say, Maverick, and he'll come right up to me, and he will put his head, that big, long forehead, and he'll put it right on my chest and just stand there. Because he is absolutely submitted to me. He looks to me for leadership. He looks to me for direction and for guidance and for security. Amen? And he'll put his, and I know that. Now, one time, now this was a long time ago, and he only did it once. He reached around and bit me in the back. And he learned instantly that that is unacceptable behavior. Amen. You might say, well, Brother Greg, what did you do? I didn't. See, now, if you don't know, you would think, yeah, the 2x4 or the shotgun or whatever. But you have to communicate with the horse in a way that they understand. And so when you are the top horse in the herd, you make the other horse's feet move and yours stay still. Whosever feet moves first is the weaker animal. And I made his feet moved until they didn't want to move anymore. Amen. And he learned instantly that that is not what you do. Amen. Now, here's the thing is that now my wife, she can take even some stranger's horse and she'll see as she's beginning the process, she'll see where there's issues or what she calls trash. And she will go in and begin to correct the trash. And then you end up with a respectful, willing partner, is what she calls it. Amen? That wants to be with you, that wants to be ridden, not take off for the barn and hide when you show up, but that wants to be with you. But here's what I have found, even with believers, a lot of times there's trash that you got to get rid of. Amen? Wrong thoughts, wrong teaching, ideas that come from tradition, or lack of experience. See, a lot of times people, they might have made an attempt to believe God in the area of healing. They might have heard a message or two on the subject of healing, and it didn't work for them. They didn't see the results that they wanted to right away. And so well, it must not be God's will. Or maybe God does that sometimes for certain people, but not for others. And what happens is, now we got trash to have to deal with. But what I do, now, I don't have the time like a pastor to teach people over the process of time and fix those problems. Here's what I have to do, is I've got to get people to a place of faith as fast as possible and release the anointing, and a certain percentage of those people are going to get healed, and a certain percentage don't. Now, I don't share that everywhere that I go. Amen? Because when I go to other places, I got to teach it like everybody gets it. But you know going in that not everybody will, because not everybody's going to be in a position of faith. You see, we talked about this already, and even out the barn we talked about this, that the anointing of God is contingent upon you believing in faith that you receive and you take what is offered to you. The woman with the issue of blood, Jesus said, daughter, your faith has made you whole. He was anointed. Was he not? Here's Philip in the book of Acts. The Bible says he went down to Samaria and preached what? Christ unto them. Christ was not Jesus' last name. He preached the anointing down there. And the scripture plainly says that the people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spake, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. Well, yes, Brother Greg, if I see the miracles, I will believe. That's putting the donkey behind the cart. No, you got to get the donkey out there in front where it belongs. The believing part comes first, the receiving and the seeing and the manifestation come second. Well, yeah, you know, I had, you know, Brother so-and-so lay hands on me, and I'm just waiting for my healing. I guess maybe just God wasn't quite ready. He did it 2,000 years ago. That is first class, unadulterated doubt and unbelief. And brother, you got it right. It's trash. And you now it's not a big deal. Get the trash out and get healed. Well, you know, maybe this is my cross to bear. It's trash. Is that plain enough? Am I being ornery enough, sister? Amen. That was kind of a, she's being polite. See, I'm from Oklahoma. I can get away with it. Pastor Dad, he's got to be nice. And, you know, isn't he just so wonderful? He'll just spoon feed you so sweetly the word of God. And he's got his little napkin to dab your chin. And he's just so wonderful about that. That's not the dad that I know. I had to go cut my own switches. And so if you don't like how I am, you can blame him. No, I'm really kind of nice outside of the anointing. But sometimes, I don't know what it is. I just get ornery and blunt sometimes. But sometimes, you know, when you look at Jesus, you know, he said scathing things to the religious people of the day. Like, how can you say that? You're the master of the universe. And how could you say that? You know, vipers. Those were scathing insults of the day. You know. Well, do you believe he did it in love? Sure he did. Well, I just want to help people. So, if you're here tonight, and I'm not going to say that you want to be prayed for, but if you want to come and take what belongs to you, then I can help you. Amen. Now, if you're coming, well, you know, we'll just see what he can do. Just don't come forward. I'll save you the time. I can't help you. Well, yeah, but you never know. God just, that's not how it works. Amen. The vast, vast majority of the time, God expects you to do what you know to do. Amen. Now, how many of you have been saved? You know you're saved. All right? And you believed in your heart on the Lord Jesus. You confessed Him with your mouth. And how many got it? That's all you got to do with this. You believe it in your heart, and you confess it with your mouth. You come with that same reception, that same idea. I'm taking salvation. I'm taking my healing right now. I'm not waiting for it. What if it doesn't happen? Did you think that way when it came to salvation? Well, what if God doesn't save me? No, you came believing that when you believed in your heart, confessed with your mouth, that you'd be saved. Amen. You come that same way with that same confidence. You see, faith for salvation is no different faith for healing. It works the same way. I believe it, and I'm going to receive it. And if you'll come, not just to be prayed for, not just to, you know, have hands laid upon you and see if you feel something or not, but if you come on purpose to take it now, that power will go into you, and it will drive out sickness, and it will drive out disease. So if you are ready right now, then come forward. Amen. Hallelujah. It does not matter what it is. It doesn't matter if it's cancer. It doesn't matter if it's diabetes. It doesn't matter if it's a heart condition. It doesn't matter if it's chronic hangnail. Whatever that it is. You're coming to take it right now. Now, what I need you ladies to do is to step forward. No, not you ladies. You're already in perfect position. But this second row here, step up so there's just one line there. Amen. Because I don't want to miss anybody. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And you that are helping, make sure that everybody's in one line right across the front. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Now, you are coming to take. You're not coming to pray. You're not coming to be busy-minded and just get quiet. And just you're coming and you take. The moment hands are laid upon you, that's when you take. The moment that hands are laid upon you, that's when you take. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we magnify you. We praise you. We'll start down this end. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Take it right now and be healed in Jesus' name. There's the anointing. There, take it right now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. We're taking it right now. In Jesus' name, we release that anointing to flow into his body from the top of his head. In Jesus' name, in the name of Jesus, we release the anointing of God to flow into her from the top of her head to the soles of her feet. In Jesus' name, Father God, by faith, there's anointing right there. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, we release the anointing to flow into her body from the top of her head to the soles of her feet. Sister, do you take it? Do you take it? Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Come on up here. Praise the Lord. Yeah. I need you to help me for just a second. You stay right where you are. She's going to put her hand right there on your chest. Okay? Right up high there. Hallelujah. Amen. Be healed in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we release the anointing. There it is. Hallelujah. There's the anointing. Just allow that anointing to go in. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just allow that anointing to go in. Praise the Lord all the way. All the way. Be healed in the name of Jesus. We allow that anointing to flow in from the top of her head to the soles of her feet. In Jesus' name. Yep, there. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We release the anointing. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, be healed. In the name of Jesus, be healed. We release the anointing. There it is, going right inside, right down into your belly. Ha, 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 ha. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Sister, put your hand on your stomach. There it is, right there. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Be healed right now in the name of Jesus. We release the anointing. Put your hand on your stomach. In the name of Jesus. From the top of her head to the soles of her feet, we release that anointing in Jesus' name. Well, the same power that heals you will drive out anything else. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, we release the anointing to flow into her body from the top of her head to the soles of her feet. Amen. Now, sister, do you receive that anointing?
I receive it.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Thank you, Lord. We just allow it to flow in Jesus' name. Be healed in the name. We allow that anointing. Just allow that anointing to go in. It's all good. Good, 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 good. Hallelujah. Be healed in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Be healed in the name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Be healed. We just allow that anointing to flow in all the way. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You receive that? Praise the Lord. Be healed. We allow that anointing flow in. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Be high. Ha, 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 ha. Thank you, Lord. Now, I'm not going to go chasing you around the building. Thank you, Lord. I've walked all the way back to the back of a church before. Now we're going to let that anointing go all the way in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Come up here. You're not receiving is the way that you should. I'm not trying to discourage you. I want to help you. Amen. Now that anointing wants to go all the way. And all you got to do is just like drinking water, just let it go, just go right in. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. We allow that anointing to flow in all the way. All the way. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Now I'm not pushing you. Just allow that anointing to go right in. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we allow that anointing to flow in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus, Father God, He'll do His part and receive by faith. And Father God, I lay my hands in faith. And Father, in the name of Jesus, I release that anointing to flow into His body from the top of His head to the very soles of His feet. In Jesus' name. Now, did you get it? Did you get it? Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus. Now I want to ask you a question. Now you're saved, right? And you believe in your heart on Jesus.
Yes.
And you confess Him as Lord.
Yes.
Now I want you to say this out loud. Say, Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father.
I believe.
That Brother Greg.
Is anointed.
With healing power.
And when He lays hands upon me.
That power.
Is going to go into me. To bring about a complete healing.
In total cure.
In Jesus' name. Now receive in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. You all right? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, be healed. In the name of Jesus, that's the anointing. And just go in. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Now, are you ready to receive? Amen. Amen. And you believe you'll be healed when I lay hands on you?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Then in the name of Jesus, be healed. We release the healing. There it is. Whoa. Thank you, Lord. We release the healing power of God to go into her body there. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. You receive that, don't you? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Now, if this will help you, all right, and that is my only desire, is to help. There was a stronger manifestation of that anointing laying hands on you than anybody else here tonight. Amen.
I wanted you to put your hand where the sore spot was.
Now, here's the thing. That anointing went into your body from your head all the way down to your feet.
Right.
And it'll affect every area of your body. Now, it's up to you to do something with that power. So if you'll say, thank you, Jesus, that power is working in me, it'll just keep working and keep working and keep working and keep working. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Now, I'm not saying that folks over here weren't healed. They were. Amen. But God meets us where we're at, you understand? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Brother, you're ready to receive? Amen. Hallelujah. You come to take it then, right? Hallelujah. Yeah. Well, Father God, in the name of Jesus, Father God, the word of God was preached. And we are acting upon that word in simple faith.
Yes.
And so, Father God, in the name of Jesus, we lay our hands upon this body, and by faith, we release the anointing to flow into his body from the top of his head to the soles of his feet. And Father God, we count it as done in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for it. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Anybody else? You guys are all good? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Lord, we magnify you. And we glorify you. We're so grateful and we're so thankful. You know, it's not a matter of hype. Not a matter of, had to have music just pitch perfect. You know, it was cold. It was calculated. It was just relying on the anointing. Amen. Now it's up to you to do something with that anointing. All I can do is be a vessel to deliver it. Amen. Hallelujah. And now it's up to you to believe that you received that. Amen. Hallelujah. Father, we're so grateful. We're so thankful for a bunch of healed people in this place.